Very good morning to all of you, and welcome back to the third and final day of this conference. I'm Won Ping, a PhD student with the Interdisciplinary Graduate School of NTU, and I'm the chairperson for this morning's session. I'm delighted and honored today to present to you Professor Geoffrey West. Professor West is a distinguished professor and the former president of the Santa Fe Institute, as well as a visiting professor here in NTU, among the many positions that he now holds. Time magazine, in 2006, named him one of the 100 most influential people in the world. He began his career in physics with great success, but about two decades ago, he set his sights upon the complex problems of cities, corporations, and global sustainability. His contributions to these areas have been without fail exciting, thought-provoking, and groundbreaking. Therefore, it is with eager anticipation that I invite Prof. West to the stage to share his thoughts on the silent threat of exponential growth and collapse.
I thought the whole idea of silent transformation was so intriguing, and the different kinds of the spectrum of ideas that could be talked about under it, and the one I chose was one that everybody is extremely familiar with, and in fact the first 15 or so 20 minutes of this talk will be embarrassingly simple. But I do want to go through ideas of exponential growth and its dominance in the world around us and what it might lead to. But in fact, the thrust of the talk will be to use that as a point of departure and talk more about the sustainability of exponential growth and the potential for collapse. In many systems, but I will mostly talk about that in terms of socio-economic systems that we all participate in. So perhaps the most dramatic of all silent transformations that we participate in, and I took silent transformation to mean something that is happening around us, that we either participate in or is somehow profound that we're not actually aware of. And even though science has made us aware of it, but we're not aware of in our daily life. And perhaps the grandest of all of them is the fact that the universe is expanding at an exponential rate. And that's quite extraordinary, and I remind you, now let's see if I can get this to work. Yes, there we go, good. So, everybody's familiar with the famous observations of Edwin Hubble, maybe 70, 80 years ago, where he, in measuring the velocity of galaxies, discovered that the further away they were, the faster they seemed to be receding, and that it happened in this extraordinarily simple way, that there was just this simple relationship between the increasing velocity and the distance that galaxy is away, and that is a signal of the fact that we live in this exponentially expanding universe, and it's very easy to see, and whoops, this is terrible. That's better. So it's very easy to see. The Hubble's observation are just simply the linear equation that the velocity is proportional to r, the constant of proportionality h is called the Hubble constant. And I'm giving a very simplistic version of this with none of the frills of relativity and so on. But the velocity is just dr dt, so that equation just says that dr dt is equal to h times r, namely that the speed is the increase in distance is proportional to the distance you already are away, and the solution to that, of course, is the classic exponential, which is so the statement that everything is receding in time at an exponential rate. And that is the universe we live in, and we're hardly aware of it. We're not only aware of it through a very sophisticated form of measurement, to a lesser degree, but in a similar way, we are also not generally in our daily lives conscious of the fact that this is mimicked in the expansion of the population of which we all live in, namely that the global population, and in fact, almost everywhere you live, is approximately increasing at an exponential rate. And I remind you that if you just take the logarithms, a nice way of representing an exponential rate, of course, is that the logarithm is a straight line when plotted against time. But also, most importantly, and this is the part that makes it so devastating, is that the increase, say, in the population or in the distance or whatever it is proportional to what's already there, which means, and this is the killer and the silent threat, and that is that when n is small, of course, the change is very small and you hardly notice it, but as this builds up, the change gets increasingly bigger and bigger in a proportional fashion. And the big problem with living in an exponential system is that you only by the time you start to notice it, it's too late. That's the typical situation, and I want to try to illustrate that. So here's us, and you can see it very dramatically. You're all very familiar with this. You've all seen this, I'm sure, many, many times. This extraordinary increase, and it's very likely that this will end up, if it ever ends up, in excess of 12 billion people. But you can see it's quite extraordinary, and here you very, very easily see this amazing increase. I was born here. So when I was born, there were only 2.3 billion people on the planet in 1940. Today, there are 7.3. It's almost, it's bigger than a factor of three, just in my pithy little lifetime. So this is quite extraordinary, and we will come back to this a little bit later. And I just want to remind you again that, of course, just in terms, because I'm going to show lots of these kinds of graphs, that this is an exponential, but if you plot it logarithmically, it's a nice, simple, straight line. So I want to make sure we're all on the same page. And I want to talk a teeny bit about ways of representing exponentials, and some of you are probably more familiar than I am. And one is a famous parable by the epic poet Fawazi, the famous Persian poet. He wrote the longest ever epic poem in about the year 1000 AD. And in that poem, he talks about the introduction of chess to Persia at that time. And he talks of the following parable about that. So chess came to Persia from India, and it was an enormous success. It was, you know, it was, it sort of took over, and the king was a great proponent of chess. And so he wanted a reward, the person that brought it from India, with a reward. And he said, look, you can have anything you want, sort of within reason, that I can give you from my kingdom. Name your price, it's yours. And this man that had brought chess to Persia said, okay, here's what I would like. I would like you to take a chessboard, and I'm sure you're all very familiar with this, and I would like you on the first, on the sorry? On A1, yes, A1. Put one grain of rice. On two, put two grains of rice. On three, four grains of rice. On four, and so forth. Just keep it geometrically progressing. And the king was very offended by this. He said, this is such a trivial gift. I'm really upset. Please name something bigger. And he said, no, that will do. I'm a very modest man. Please do it. So the next day, the king saw this man wandering around the palace, and said, well, are you happy with your reward? And he said, I haven't got it yet. And he called the Grand Vizier and said, what has happened? Why hasn't he got his reward? And he said, we're not even halfway through the board and we've run out of all the rice in the kingdom. And of course, that is the very essence of an exponential, and you're familiar with it. There it is, and you can see very quick the first line, you only have 128 to the top right hand. Then you only have 30,000, you only have 8 million. But by here, you're already at 500 billion. And indeed, if you do the simple arithmetic, of course, if you ask how many end up on this bottom square, of course, it's this number, which is. And by the way, it's worth doing a little homework. If you take a typical grain of rice and you ask, how big is this? It's bigger than the Himalayas. If you laid a typical grain of rice end to end, it would go to Andromeda and back, this amount. It's more than 100 times what is produced on the planet today in terms of rice. So this is the nature of exponential. It's just a little parable. And it will come back to haunt us. And the reason I'm doing this is because I give quite a lot of talks to people in business and who are somehow associated with policy and so on. And one of the things I have that has stressed me so much is that people do not get exponentials. They don't understand what an they use the word all the time. It's growing exponentially fast. They don't understand that if the, which I will come to in a minute, the GDP is not 3% this quarter, but it's only 1%, and we should throw the president out of the office, 1% still means it's exponential growth. And exponential growth has built into it this horrific situation. Okay, onwards. So that's a side polemic. So there's the GDP, has exactly the same. And here it is. Here's the US GDP from the sort of the roughly the middle of the 19th century. And there it is with all the dips and the bumps and the depression and all the other things. And this yellow line is just an exponential, just drawn in, pure exponential. So you can see, on the average, we just keep following this exponential expansion as if it's, you know, it's God-given. And this, of course, is the driving force behind all the marvelous things that we reap in terms of society. But that's what we're following. And all these things that freak us out every few years are just, on this scale, just minor fluctuations. And the analog to the chess game is this. If you invested in about the Civil War, 1860 or so, $1 in the US stock market, you would now, that dollar would now be worth $1 million, for example. Just put it in, just follow the stock market. So you can see there's that beautiful exponential. It's plotted logarithmically. Okay, so we live in an expanding physical universe, we live in an expanding population universe, we live in an expanding, exponentially expanding economic universe, but we also live in an expanding, urbanizing socio-economic universe, which takes it somewhat broader. And I just give some numbers here. We could do it for many different places, including Singapore. 200 years ago, the US was just a few percent, as was the planet, a few percent urbanized. It's now over 80%. That is, the US is. The world will almost certainly go to close to 80% towards the end of the century. We crossed the halfway mark a few years ago, and we're just on this same cruise of exponential expansion. And just to give you again a sense of what that means, it's roughly speaking the equivalent to adding, if you just average between now, just a linear average between now and the middle of the century, That's equivalent to adding, actually, it's like 1.4 million people a week, which is like adding a New York metropolitan area every couple of months from now to 2050, or to adding a Singapore every month on this planet. That's what we're doing. That's the projection. That's what's happening. And that is an enormous challenge for the planet in terms of every kind of resource, in terms of building the infrastructure to that, and the threat of that in terms of the disruption, let alone the scarcity of resources and the fight for new resources, is going to be quite substantial. And you saw a little bit of it yesterday in the talk yesterday afternoon. And you saw pictures like this. Again, I'm sure if we'd been able to take satellite pictures in the year I was born, it would look a very dull version of that, extremely dull. Most of it would not shine bright like that, or like that, or like that. This is, you know, this kind of virus, this filigrane virus that is taking over the planet, is happening at an exponential rate. And just to give you another sense of things, China, this is the urbanization of China, and China is just about crossing the halfway point. It came very late to urbanization. And in order to catch up, in order to deal with the extraordinary expansion of its economy in the last years and what's coming up, China is trying to build 200 to 300 new cities in the next 15 to 20 years, in each in excess of 1 million people. So that's just China, let alone India, let alone Latin America, and so forth. So this is an enormous stress on the planet, and it's something that is enormous threat coming out of this exponential expansion. Okay, so there it is, just pictorially again. Everything, this idea that everything is expanding open-endedly in this exponential. Actually, I use the word exponential, but much of this is actually faster than exponential. So one of the things I will talk about is this whole question of the fate of the planet. And it's clear, I think, that the fate of the planet is bounded with the fate of the cities, how cities develop, what their impact will be more generally, is crucial for understanding the ultimate fate of the planet in terms of the kind of socio-economic life many of us have become accustomed to. So this whole question of exponential growth is a very old one. It goes back mostly to Thomas Malthus, just about 200 years ago when this exponential growth started, and he realized that there was a potential problem, that ultimately the demands would completely outpace the resources, and he said that the whole thing would collapse, and he had all kinds of social implications for that, which were quite draconian, actually. He was much trashed because he made predictions that the whole thing would fall apart in less than 50 years, that by 1850 the whole thing would fall apart, and he gave predictions for populations which were completely wrong, based on the idea that there would be exponential growth, but that the support system would only be increasing linearly. And the reason that he did not, and by the way, let me jump ahead briefly. I've written down the Club of Rome. Many of you would have heard of it, but at least the older people would have heard of it. But it was a consortium, so to speak, of industrialists in the early 1970s that had a project going at MIT try to look. It was the first serious attempt to simulate the whole question of sustainability. And they also basically concluded that this was unsustainable in the present paradigm. So, but they were also, like Malthus, they were trashed. And in fact, the predictions, and especially the predictions of questions of population were, and of the kind of the fate, the Armageddon that was supposed to happen by now, never happened. And the reason for that, the fundamental reason for that, was that almost none of these studies took into account the role of innovation. And of course, the thing that saved the question of Malthus and his focus on agriculture was that we did not recognize that there would be these enormous innovations in agriculture, ending up more recently with the Green Revolution and so on. And so what that has led to is a curse, in my opinion. And that curse is, and I'm looking at my dear friend Brian up here, the curse of the economists who believe that, sure, exponential growth, but who gives a shit? We're always going to be able to innovate our way out of it. That's the solution. It's a mantra. It's extraordinary that people can get Nobel Prizes and not understand innovation and understand where it comes from and why, and still say these things. And I find this appalling, and and I want to try to illustrate that with the rest of the talk, actually. So we'll come back to this. Okay, so I've so far emphasized the exponential expansion of all these things, but in fact, most of the world around us, the biological world, the interesting part of the world around us, the biological world, the complexity of that world, has built into it something that is self-limiting. It does not expand exponentially. Despite all the stuff you see around us and all the growth that takes place and so forth, it does not expand exponentially, and just as you don't. That's you, except in the form of a rat, but that's you. You grow, you start exponentially, but then you taper off and you stop, and then you spend most of your life in this relatively stable state, eventually towards the end here, dying, and if I had time, I'll relate to that later. But that's typical. It's typical of, this is a bacterial colony, and you see the same kind of thing, same kind of sigmoidal curve, the leveling off. And here's just a cartoon, not of mine, but of a typical life cycle of a colony, and notice in a closed system. So the colony grows quickly. There's, you see, this exponential growth. It levels off, and then it dies. Then it collapses if it's in a closed system. And biology, of course, evolved not in a closed system, as a life did not evolve in a closed system. We get the sun shines all the time. The sad thing about human beings is, on the one hand, we discovered that we could close the system, because we discovered fossil fuels. And that's great, because by discovering fossil fuels, it gave rise to this exponential expansion. But by closing the system, we're forcing ourselves, this is into this, what is called death phase. And I will elaborate on this further. OK, so I want to talk a little bit now about biology from this viewpoint and ask, what is the underlying mechanism that leads to this curve instead of the open-ended curve? Why is it that you go on eating, all of you were gobbling stuff out there and eating breakfast this morning, but you know for sure, I don't think anybody in this room looking around is going to grow, you're going to grow this way a little bit, but you're not going to grow, you know, ontogenetically, so to speak. So why is that? So I want to explain that, and then I want to then move back to the social organization. So here's us, for example. We're one of these. We cover 100 million in scale in terms of our size, from the little shrew to the blue whale. And you know, in terms of almost anything that you could measure at a coarse-grain level, despite appearances, we're actually scaled versions of one another. So, for example, the most fundamental quantity, and I'm going to emphasize this throughout, the most fundamental quantity of life, in fact, of any system, and in fact, and in particular of any complex adaptive system, is energy. Nothing happens without energy. You can't even exchange information without energy. You can't have a single thought without energy. So here's metabolic rate. That's the amount of energy in terms of food that you take in and metabolize per day, plotted versus size. And what you see is something extraordinary, is that there's this incredible simplicity when plotted logarithmically. That's log-log plot, so you can get a mouse and an elephant on the same plot. And what you see is that a very simple straight line, indicative of a very simple power law relationship. And several things I want to point out about it. First of all, that there is any regularity whatsoever, because each one of these organisms and each subsystem of these organisms, each cell type, each genome, has evolved with its own unique evolutionary history, with its own unique environmental niches and so forth. And yet, despite that, despite all the forces of natural selection, we have what we see is an extraordinary regularity occurring, which means that something was constraining the way natural selection acted on questions of energy usage. Secondly, the slope of this is very close to this number 3/4, 0.75, which is less than 1. And less than 1 means that there is a systematic economy of scale, meaning per gram or per cell, the bigger you are, the less energy you need to stay alive, because this is increasing. If it were linear, then it would be the same all the way through. If it's sublinear, less than 1, 3/4, and I'll show you that in a minute, just to make sure we're all on the same page. But this 3/4 power law is true. This is very old data, but it's true across all of life. Any taxonomic group you want to look at has this. I could show you tons and tons of data on this. But it all has this same 3/4 power. There's offsets because of different body designs that have evolved. And even down through bacteria, unicells, all the way down to the molecules of the respiratory complex, which is the molecules that allow us to stay alive. So it's the same plot, rate of energy use versus size. And you can see, and that line actually is drawn in to be exactly 3/4, coming down from the ones above. And even for plants and trees, which have a completely different design. OK, so here it is in statement. So here it is, metabolic rate goes as mass of 3/4. That means the metabolic rate per unit mass is decreasing with size, which roughly means, on the average, the metabolic rate of a cell is decreasing as mass of the 1/4, which means this is the cells for bigger animals are doing less work, need to do less work than smaller ones. That's what I meant by economy of scale, and it's systematic and therefore predictable. And I've just said it again, but what is sort of even more extraordinary is that if you look at any quantity that is measurable, physiological quantity that is measurable about organisms, or any quantity that represents their life history, how many offspring they have, how long they live, how long they take to mature, and so on. Roughly speaking, at this coarse grain level, there are similar scaling laws, and I think I do show a couple here. Here's a very mundane one, heart rate, okay, versus size. You see a systematic decrease. This decreases very closely to mass to the minus 1/4. Here's white matter to gray matter in the brain, increasing approximately as 5/4. And here's genome length. There's much more variance in the data. But again, the slope, this is a best fit, is very close to minus 1/4. And what you see is, I forget if I have any more, but typically what you see, and I could show 50 to 100 of these damn graphs, and they all have similar characteristics. They're all power laws, meaning on a log-log plot, they're very close to straight lines, and the slopes of them are typically multiples of 1/4. So 1/4 seems to play a special role, and I will elaborate on that in a minute. And this is known as quarter power scaling by some, allometric quarter power scaling. So I saw Tom is here, and I'm so sorry to miss his talk. The data, I just threw this in not to take the scaling law so seriously, because there's lots of variance about scaling, about lifespan. but I wanted to point out something that, very roughly speaking, lifespan scales as mass of the 1/4, and I just showed you the heart rate scales as mass of the minus 1/4. You multiply them together, the mass of the 1/4s cancel, so the total number of heartbeats in a lifespan is an approximate invariant. So little things live very fast, little things live very fast and die young, big things live very slowly and live a long time. And there's just some data, some old data, and that line, you can see this is the number of heartbeats in a lifespan. You can see it's pretty good. But the important thing is actually on top, is really that, you know, there's nothing very fundamental about hearts, but there is something fundamental about the amount of times that the machinery inside your cells, the so-called respiratory complex, is producing ATP, which is your currency of energy, and very approximately in respiratory metabolism, which is how most of us function, the number of times that reaction takes place is an approximate invariant, which is sort of amazing, given that we all evolved by natural selection. And here's another invariant, which is the total energy used per lifespan, per unit gram, and you can see over many orders of magnitude, it's roughly speaking, stays constant. So these are just important things to keep in mind. They're not immediately germane to this talk, but I wanted to throw them in. So the question is, where do these scaling laws and all the rest of this come from? And some work that I was involved in some years ago was the idea that what is common to all of these different scaling laws and why they are similar and similarly expressed in very, very differently evolved engineered designs, whether you have a beating heart and this kind of circulatory system, or your plant or a tree, which of course does not have a beating heart and does not have tubes branching off like this, has fibers all joined together, and so on, that kind of thing, and so on. Why is it that different body types and different designs have evolved the same kinds of scaling laws, and where in the hell did the scaling laws come from anyway, is invoked in an idea that they all are derivative of the physics and mathematics and generic properties of networks that sustain life. That life should be thought of in this, from this view, as the result of being sustained as a result of the geometry and dynamics of networks. So the obvious ones being things like your circuitry and respiratory system, but they could be networks within cells and so forth, so, or obviously plants. So I'm not going to, this is not the talk to go through any of the details, but there's just some of the kinds of networks. This is us, this is a cell, these are microtubule networks, and mitochondrial networks within cells. That's a mitochondrion, and that's your brain, and so forth. So there's these networks, and the idea is all of these have similar properties, and I'm not going to go through them, but the point is that you have to put these properties, and the kinds of properties, by the way, are, just to give you a sense of it, are that, and they're considered derivative of natural selection, that if you have, say we take all mammals have essentially the same fundamental units. So our capillaries, a capillary of a whale, and a capillary of a cow, and a capillary of a human being, and that of a shrew, even though they're vastly different sizes and they look completely different, actually are the same because natural selection built on those as the fundamental units and built up from that in terms of, say, building a respiratory system, did not operate on the fundamental units themselves. Anyway, those kinds of ideas and the ideas of optimization, which is a very strong one, so that, for example, the circulatory systems that we have are the ones that we all share as mammals, are the ones that minimize the amount of energy we have to do in order to keep ourselves alive, pumping blood through our circulatory system, so we can optimize, so you minimize that to optimize the energy that you can devote to sex and reproduction, and therefore to a kind of classic form of fitness. So if you do all that, and you take these ideas of these networks and you put them into mathematics and turn all the cranks and write it all down and solve all the equations, which I'm not going to show you, what you discover is that the metabolic rate should scale with the size of the system, the mass there on the top there, as a power law. And that power law is reflective of the optimization which gives rise to the fractal nature, the self-similarity within you of these networks is reflected in the power law and the self-similarity between you and other organisms. And it gets expressed in the scaling laws that we just saw, like the one at the top, where D is the dimension of the space you happen to live in. I am a theoretical physicist, so I worked it out in D dimensions. And it's kind of instructive because you see where we live, most animals live in three dimensions. Most of us live in three dimensions. So D is three, and you can see you get three quarters. But what you see is that the quarter, this ubiquitous quarter, is actually is not really four, it's actually three plus one. And so it's a combination of the dimensionality of space we live in, and the plus one is to do with the wonders of fractal geometry, which I will not go into. Anyway, so we understand where this comes from, where these come from, and I'm just flashing this on of all the multiple predictions you can have for these various systems, plants and trees and respiratory systems and forests and so forth. And I'm going to miss this out. And the one thing I am going to remind you of, though, is that the metabolic rate of a cell, so the theory then says the metabolic rate of a cell should decrease as mass to the minus one quarter. But the metabolic rate of a cell sets the time scale for everything else that happens in an organism. So you have this idea that the pace of life systematically decreases with the size of a system, and this will be important later. So I want to take this now, having given that little summary, I want to take this and apply it to growth, which all of us have gone through a process like this, and I'm going to write it down in a moment in an equation, but you all know, so to speak, how you grew. You ate, you metabolized, you sent that metabolic energy through your circulatory system to feed the cells. At the cells, that energy either repaired damage or maintenance in general to cells. And if cells died, it replaced them with new ones. And in a growth phase, it added new cells. So that's kind of the idea. And that's just a picture of it. And here it is in English. The metabolized energy, sort of roughly speaking, gets, I've left out some bells and whistles here, but this is the simplified version. It goes to maintenance and growth, and here it is in mathematics. By the way, just a side comment, we heard a talk yesterday on bilingualism, which was very interesting, extremely interesting, and I did want to ask a question then, I didn't have a chance, but I'm not, in the usual sense, I'm not bilingual at all. I barely seem to manage English, but I'm hopeless in other languages. But I'm extraordinarily bilingual in mathematics and English. And I feel this very strongly because one of the things you discover as a theoretical physicist is that to a large extent, you know, many things, mathematics is the language of the universe, turns out. It's amazing. It's a miracle, actually. Allows us to do all this. So I decided, after some thought, to allow equations. This is directed to you, to put some equations. We're at a technological university, we should be free to write equations. Okay, so there it is. So here's what this says, this in English. So this is in English, which you could translate into any language on the planet. But none of them would be very useful except for this language. This is much more useful than translating it into Mandarin or Albanian. So here it is. B is the metabolic rate. What happens to it? The maintenance is the first term. the number of cells that are there times the metabolic rate of the cell, and that is the stuff that keeps the cell going. And then you add the energy needed to create a cell times the rate at which you're creating cells. So this is the simplest version you could write down of the energy budget, so to speak, of an organism. And you now use, I'm not going to go through this, of course, but this is linear in the mass, the number of cells, but the metabolic rate, because of the constraints of the network, only increases as the mass to the three quarters, namely the number of cells to the three quarters. So if you boil all this down and you put it into this simple equation for the mass, you see that the rate of change of mass, this thing here, is this term minus this term, this coming from the metabolic rate and this coming from this linear term in maintenance. And what you see is that the exponent here, 1, is bigger than the 3/4, and the sublinearity of this means that eventually dmdt goes to 0, whether you like it or not. It stops. So built into that extraordinary economy of scale that is implicit in the structure of our networks is the necessity for growth to stop. dmdt goes to 0, and which you could calculate how big you're going to get if you want. One of the nice things about this equation is that it only depends on 2 parameters, but both of those are, I'll use the word universal. This is the overall scale of metabolism. This is the average mass of a cell, average energy needed to create a cell, the average metabolic rate of a cell, and so forth. And here's the solution, very simple. And what you see is that there's an exponential decay as you get bigger. Okay? So in fact, in this picture, you don't actually even start exponentially. You start actually with a very big power law, it turns out, which is almost indistinguishable from an exponential. But you inevitably, you grow fast, dominated by this term. This term, when m is small, beats this term, but eventually this beats this. So this is that picture that I showed is, in fact, that's the data. And there's the fit, and the fit is with these 2 parameters which are determined not from growth, from other things. And you see it's very good. And important to note is the following, is the reason that it turns over and stops is that it was this sublinear scaling, this 3/4. Okay. So just to show you, that happens to be an extremely good fit, but the other one's not as good. With the same parameters, you get, you see it's very good. There's fish, birds, mammals, and so on. And you can take the theory, and the theory can tells you that instead of plotting them in this way, mass versus age, instead of doing that, plot it in this dimensionless form. That is, you rescale. I'm not going to go into this. I'm not going to waste your time. But if you rescale it appropriately, given by the equations, the theory tells you how to do it. If you plot it this way, it says everybody grows in the same way. All growth curves collapse to the same growth curve. And there it is for just some of them. So they all do it. And even here, there's some other people took this idea and took it to insects and even to insect colonies. Now we're getting more to something more social. To insect colonies, there's more outliers, but you can see it's pretty damn good. And more recently, we took it and applied it to cancer. Talk about a silent transformation. There's a silent transformation. And here's, this is not some oncologists took our theory and applied it to various cancers. And there it is, and there it is. And this is what we did. We took the cancer data and put it on the organismic data to show that it's the same, which is kind of interesting because you ask the question, what's the difference between growing a cancer and growing an organ? And actually, not much, according to this, pretty much the same, except it turns out, just a side comment, there's much more variance. The cancers try to violate in some way. But basically, it follows pretty much the same graph. And importantly to notice is that that despite the image of cancer as exponentially growing, they don't exponentially grow. Only at the very beginning do they exponentially grow. And cancers, if you could live long enough, stop, like you do. They're just like you. They are you, of course. So they stop. So just one wild idea, of course, if you could somehow tweak the parameters of cancer, maybe it's OK to grow cancers, but you just they stop small enough, and you just live with them. That would be great, much better than carving bits out of you and all the rest of it that happens, that you have to do, of course. OK, so this is just a summary from this viewpoint, this viewpoint of what I want to say about biology, and then I want to take it to cities and, if I have time, to companies. So there's these extraordinary scaling laws. They're nonlinear. We understand that, well, they express an economy of scale. The pace of life systematically slows with increasing size, the plodding elephant versus the scurrying mouse kind of thing. Growth is sigmoidal and stops. We have a finite lifespan. We die, and I didn't go into that. But and all of this can be explained by to do with the dynamics and geometry of networks. Okay, so now I want to go back to this, and I want to take this idea and see how did we as socioeconomic creatures violate this? We satisfied it up till about 10,000 years ago, and I didn't show you data. It's pretty hokey data, but we have data on hunter-gatherer societies and so on, which look just like organisms and bacterial communities. They stop growing. You know, they reach about maybe at most a couple of hundred, typically much smaller, but they stop. But somehow when we transitioned, when we learned language and we communicated, we exchanged information, a whole new dynamic was brought to the planet, and somehow we violated it, and I want to talk a little bit about that. So I just was saying, as I said earlier, this whole exponential growth is a huge issue. It is the reason, of course, why we have all these extraordinary challenges from global climate change to questions of resources, everything from water, energy, so forth, pollution, the environment, questions of health. All of these have come about because of the exponential growth of urbanization. It all happens in the city because that's where the people are. And by the way, none of these problems, all of this tsunami of problems we face, of course, have been with us for at least 200 years. They're not new. None of them are new. Even 20 years ago, we were hardly conscious of them. And 200 years ago, when Malthus brought them up, and 50 years ago when the Club of Rome and Paul Ehrlich brought them up and so on, they were trashed because we weren't conscious of them. And that is the nature of the exponential. Suddenly, they're upon us. Suddenly, the whole world seems to be a huge challenge, whereas it didn't seem quite the same kind of challenge not so long ago. Okay. So cities are the problem, but they're also the solution, again, because not just where all the people are, but it's where all the smart people are. All ideas, all innovations, roughly speaking, come from urban environments. And they come from urban environments because not just where the people are, but ideas and innovation are created by this, by people interacting, talking, bringing them together, and churning the pot. Okay. So I'm going to miss all this because I'm getting late. So let's talk about cities. Well, we all know what cities look like. This is a lovely city, Melbourne. This is a lovely city too. That's this one. And of course, cities are attractive because they have associated with them material well-being, greater opportunity, culture, access to greater culture, a certain buzz, certain quality of life that you don't get in a small town or in a rural situation. You get fancy schmancy restaurants, better education, and so forth. But to remind you again, none of that happens unless you are supplied by energy. If you don't have energy, none of this can happen. not a single innovation can happen, not a single thought, as I said, can happen unless we're supplied by energy. So if you supply something with energy, you pay a price. That's called the second law of thermodynamics. Second law of thermodynamics says that if you process energy or transform energy, you don't do it 100% efficiently, and you create entropy, and that is the most fundamental law in the universe. And one of the things that comes out of in these systems, something I will call socio-economic entropy, comes out of social processing of energy, and that's things like this that are a result of it that you're familiar with. Okay? Disease, all of these things, even this. No doubt, in my mind, a significant portion of all the social unrest that goes on and the multiple political problems that are put in the guise of political differences and, in particular, religious and ethnic differences are driven to some extent by some of these issues. Okay, and the question is that the asymptotic state of the system? Is that what we're all going to look like in 20, 50, 100 years? Hopefully not. Or even this. Is this what it's going to be? And so these are the issues. And I would say that in order to avoid this, if we are going to seriously attack them, then we must recognize that urbanization has played a central role in this. And until we come to terms with asking, is there a science of cities, from my own viewpoint, can we understand what it is about cities that's brought us to this, and what can we do to change it? I think it's hopeless. That is, and in particular, the city is a place where everything comes together, and in treating each one of these problems separately, whether it's climate change, energy, health, water, whatever, treating them independently, which is effectively what we do, we're not going to solve them. We all know, all of us that have studied complex adaptive systems know that they're highly coupled, they're highly interrelated, and it's extremely it can be extremely misleading at best to treat them independently. So cities is a great place for seeing them as an integrated whole, in an integrated holistic way. Okay, so that was the view of the city that I gave, but Shakespeare, who knew everything, knew also that the city isn't all its buildings and roads and infrastructure. That's only a part of it, and in fact, is the subdominant part of it. The most important part of a city is the whole bloody point of having a city. It's the people. It's this. This is what a city's for, is for bring people together to interact, to meet, bullshit together, do this kind of stuff together, and do this. This is Singapore, by the way, and so forth. And this, which is one of the great pictures, I think, of all time. It's a picture of New York about 120 years ago, and it says it all about a city. There is infrastructure, obviously, there's infrastructure. And by the way, that infrastructure is still there. It's still essentially identical. But there's all these people talking, interacting, thinking of ideas, trying to be entrepreneurial, and so forth. This is creating. This is what it's all about. This is what a city is for. It's a cauldron. It's a place for heating up the system and creating more and more interactions, new ideas, and so on. So that's the positive side of cities. But and of course, this dichotomy between the physicality of a city and the socioeconomic side of a city is reflected conceptually in the difference between thermodynamics, the energy resource, the physicality, metabolism in biology, infrastructure, say, in cities, versus information, which is kind of genomics and information exchange in biology, or innovation coming out of information exchange in socioeconomic systems, in cities in particular. Okay. So at the back of my mind are these questions. Are we sustainable? Are there quantitative predictive laws of life in general? Or, you know, it's a question. It's not clear at all there could be a science of cities. Could be that it's impossible, that every city is so unique and so different and is so historically contingent that that's impossible. But one has to start somewhere and start looking. So, okay, those are the questions. So the first question, taking this biological paradigm that proves successful in getting a kind of coarse-grained picture of some of the dynamics and some of the major features of organisms, the question is, can we do the same kind of thing with cities and companies, which I probably won't have time to get to? But the first question is, are city-scaled versions one another? I mean, what we learned in biology is that the whale lives in the ocean, and the giraffe has a long neck, and an elephant a trunk, and we walk on 2 feet, and the mouse scurries around, and so forth. And they look quite different. But in fact, in terms of measurable quantities, physiological and life history quantities, they're actually, to a pretty good approximation, scaled versions of one another. And the question is, in an urban system, is New York a scaled-up Los Angeles, which is a scaled-up Chicago, which is a scaled-up Santa Fe, despite the fact they look completely different? They have different histories, geographies, and cultures. Well, there's no point. You can't sit around and argue that. You have to look at data. So I'm going to show you some data, I think. Oh, so one last point. In being motivated by this, one realizes that despite these extraordinary differences, all cities are network systems, just like biology is, organisms are. So there's there's the obvious networks and all the networks you can't see. I mean, the cables and the water pipes and all the rest. The transport systems, and they're supplied by energy, which comes through networks, and so on. So there's reason to believe maybe there's some possibility that there is some similarity with what we did before. Furthermore, in terms of the social interaction, we also know it's networks. That's what we do. We interact via our social networks, and important in that is a certain modularity in those networks, that we group ourselves in terms of families and in terms of our jobs and so on. We are very modularly group-oriented, I don't have time to go much more into that, but I'll come back to it in a few minutes with some data. But so here's some very, very early, the earliest data that we put together. And this is something very mundane. This is the number of gas stations, petrol stations, as a function of city size. It's plotted in the same log-log way for a bunch of European cities. And what you see is that it looks just like biology in the sense that you get reasonable scaling curves. There are power laws. It's a straight line roughly on a log-log plot. And roughly speaking, the slopes of these are all roughly speaking the same, and they're all sublinear. Not surprisingly, there's an economy of scale. The bigger you are, bigger city needs less gas stations per capita. Not surprising. What is surprising, that economy of scale is roughly the same across all of these. And in fact, if you look across the globe in completely different cultures, you find very similar graphs. And I'll come back to that in a moment. But so this was sort of like biology, except the slope of this wasn't 0.75. It's much like 0.85. So more interesting are things that never occur in biology. And that's to do with social interactions. The thing that we're doing now, as I say, the thing that where we communicate, get feedback, we have positive feedback mechanisms. More interaction produces more ideas, which produces more interaction, and so forth. And that gets reflected in the socioeconomic quantities like total wages versus size, or so-called super creatives, people like everybody in this room, versus size. And the slope of these are bigger than one. It's about 1.15 for both of these, roughly. And here it is for patents, which is a little bit bigger. It's closer to 1.2. Here is for crime. It's also close to 1.2 in Japan. Here's police on the left, tax receipts. They all look, but they're amazing. They all scale, cities scale, despite they look very different. And we have looked at data across the globe in Latin America, in China, Japan, in any country where we could get data. And they all look like this, and they all have the same slopes, all having the same roughly speaking, 1.15 for socio-economic quantities. And just to show you the universality, this is just for the US, but just put on one graph and renormalized appropriately, just showing income, GDP, crime, and patents all on the same graph, showing this sort of 1.15, this 15%, I mean, roughly speaking, 15% increase with every doubling. And I put this back in, actually, I'd taken this out, but yesterday there was a conversation about cities and the size of cities and megacities. And one of the curious spin-offs of getting bigger cities and getting bigger economies of scale is the bigger you are, therefore the less infrastructure you need per capita, therefore the smaller your carbon footprint per capita. So the greenest city in the United States is New York City, and where I live is one of the worst, despite the fact that it's much more pristine and a much more pleasant place to live in many ways. Okay. So just to put it all together for this, if you double the size of a city, on average, you systematically increase all of these socioeconomic quantities, income, wealth, patents, colleges, creative people, police, disease, crime, all kinds of things, including social interactions, all by approximately 15% regardless of the city. And at the same time, you save 15% on all infrastructure. No wonder people are flocking to cities. You gain at the individual level, because you're very good at thinking you're going to avoid getting more disease and more crime, but the greater opportunity. And collectively, we gain because we have this extraordinary economy of scale. Okay, so where does all this come from? How can it be that cities in Japan and China and cities in Portugal and the United States, these urban systems, all behave in the same way? They didn't consult with each other. There was almost no interaction during the evolutionary period in which they grew. So what's going on? What is it that is universal about them? Well, the universality is, of course, that what I mentioned earlier, they are there because of people. That's the whole point of cities, is to have people. And at this level of granularity, people in different cultures with different histories are pretty much the same. There are no cultures that have 40 children, for example. Almost all group sizes, there's this famous work, which is a bit controversial, Robin Dunbar, if you ask how many best friends do you have, that number is, roughly speaking, universally 4 to 6, no matter who you are. Even if you live in a family of 15 to 20 people, the people that you're most close to is roughly this number. So there are these kind of universalities, and it is that which is being reflected in these scaling laws. So I want to show you, I want to go back to this graph, and so I'm not going to show you any of the theory, but you can immediately make a prediction from this. So all these things, this is just the data, and you say, okay, underlying this is because all of these have come about because of social interactions between people. Therefore, if I can measure the social interaction independently, it should scale just like this. So if I can remember how often people interact with each other, well, that's been very difficult until recently, but now with the coming of the cell phone, the mobile phone, we can do it. And so we teamed up with colleagues at MIT. We got hold of billions and billions of this data on cell phones, and looked at how does the level of interaction, when you analyze these cell phone connections between people, how does that scale with the size of the city? And an interaction means I call Jan, and within 6 months, he calls me back. We took that as the threshold for an interaction. Okay, so here it is. There it is. This is that connectivity versus population. And this is, one of these is England, one of these is England, and one is Portugal. And you see they lie on top of one another, and the slope of them is basically the same as the slope of that. So that just gives credence to the idea that, yes, underlying this has something to do with social interactions. As I say, I'm not going to show you the theory, but I will show you a couple. I'm going to miss this out because it's late. And I'm going to show you one or two last things and finish up. And that is, you can prove a very interesting theorem, which is kind of extraordinary, actually, I think. And that is the following. You know, if you think of a city, you think of Singapore. There's all these people going around, they're driving here, driving there, and so on. But if you think about what they're doing, mostly what they're doing is they're going from their home to work and back again. Most of the time, or they're going from their home to the cinema and back again. Their home to the mall and back again. That's what they're doing. Most of the journeys are like that. So we have cell phone data on everybody's interaction, everybody's cell phone calls in several places around the planet. And it's not just me calling you, but it's where you are and where I am. So this is detailed. So it's as if in this room we had a tag on every molecule and we knew how fast it was moving, who it was bumping into, and so on. It's amazing. Of course, for molecules, it's useless data, actually. But for cities, it's quite useful. So we took that data, and here's the theorem you can get from the theory, that you make some strong assumptions. You assume that people on the average are trying to travel from here to there, to work or to the store or to the cinema, as in the quickest and shortest way possible. Okay? They're trying to optimize their travel. If you do that, then you can derive a very simple result that the flow rate, the number of people coming from a distance, so you choose a point in the city, someplace in Singapore, and I will show you data on Singapore. You choose a point in Singapore, and you ask how many people are coming 1 kilometer, 5 kilometers, 10 kilometers, and how many of those are coming once a week, twice a week, once every 6 months to that particular place. So that's what that means. That's that distance and frequency. And it says it should go as an inverse square law. And here's the data. Here's data. I forget where this is from. You can see on the top graph is that flux of visitors to that point for different frequencies, but function of distance r. And that is almost exactly an inverse square law. And here it is here plotted versus this combination of variables, RF. And here is that same thing plotted for 4 different places, Boston, Lisbon, Dakar, and Singapore. And you can see they all line up beautifully on this. This is the theory, the inverse square. And just to emphasize it, this is just Boston taking many places around Boston looking at all the different places. And each one of those is the individual place. And you can see this inverse square law at work, which means that there is an extraordinary, talk about silent. So we're moving around in this hodgepodge, which has this image of like a gas, but it's not like a gas at all. We're actually unbelievably regular. So in planning a city, if you don't take into account this, if you don't understand that this is what the flux is when you're putting in a new mall or a new development, I suppose the least statement is you're certainly not optimizing. Anyway, that's the beginnings of a theory of city. So the last thing I want to do is on this, I think, is I want to do two things. Give me a few more minutes because I want to get to growth. So one is that we said these are back to front. Sublinear scaling in biology, the pace of life slows. But if it's superlinear scaling, it turns out the theory says the pace of life speeds up. Everything gets faster. The bigger the city, as cities grow, life gets faster in a predictable way. And here's a simple example. That's biology. That's heart rates decreasing. This is the speed of walking in cities increasing with city size. And it's pretty good in a pretty good agreement with the theory. And I show you this picture because it's gotten so bad that in Liverpool, in England, they introduced a speed lane for walking because people were getting upset that people weren't walking fast enough, so they put a speed lane. This is just a few months ago. Okay, I want to finish off with the growth equation very quickly. It's the same growth equation. Incoming, you come in, you maintain, and you grow. Same thing. Okay, and there it is in mathematics. I'm not going to do it. There it is in mathematics, mathematics. The only difference is that we have superlinear scaling, and instead of getting this, which is what we saw, I'm just going to symbolically do it, you get this. That superlinear scaling, getting that positive feedback, keeps growing on itself. So when naturally, when you solve the equations, you get this exponential growth. Actually, it's faster than exponential generally, and the data is faster than exponential. And but built into it is, into the theory, is that at some point the system is inevitably going to collapse. It will collapse. And there's the collapse. So the theory, that's if you just follow the equations through, based on those superlinear scaling laws, based on the structure of social infrastructural networks. And the question is, how in the hell do you avoid that? How did we avoid it? So I want to finish off a little bit with this. So here it is. So here's just symbolically a cartoon version. You start out and you grow superlinearly. But that's based on a certain paradigm. That is, you discover iron a long time ago, or now you discovered coal, or recently you invented computers. That's the paradigm there. That's the major innovation that dominates this. And the idea is that how do you avoid collapse? If you kept on that, you would collapse, is that at some stage you have to reset the clock by innovating. So this is the driver of innovations. In order to avoid collapse, you start again, and then you go off, and indeed you would collapse if you went on. So there's a little theorem you can prove that if you want to have continuous open-ended growth, you have to have continuous cycles of innovation. Not surprising. But what is surprising is that, you know, if you believe the theory, that the pace of life is increasing every time you go up one of these curves, so life is getting faster. But more damning is the time between innovations has to get faster and faster. So something that may have taken 100 years, 500 years ago to develop, now will only take 15 years, and so on. So the clock, which is generated by the emergent behavior of social interactions, speeds up according to these laws. And this is not mine, this is someone else showing that. I was quite surprised he plotted it in a similar way. I don't have time because I've gone on too long. And finally, things like this, which show, again, that effect of this is the time before the present when the innovation took place, and this is time, how long it took to make that innovation. So it took a long time for life to emerge, but it happened a long time ago. But personal computers took a very short time to emerge, and they happened just a moment ago, and so it all is. And the theory predicts the shape of that curve. Okay, I think I better finish there. I would just finish with one statement going back to our economist friends. This came out last year, Paul Krugman, who was getting more and more angry, I think, about sustainability questions. And he says that, you know, why is energy so special? Energy, shmenergy, what the hell? You know, these guys don't know. And in that article, he says, hard scientists, meaning I suppose people like me, who think they are smarter than economists. Because we believe in energy and second law of thermodynamics and exponential curves can't be sustained and so on. Oh, what a twit, I thought. Anyway, so I'll finish. He writes a very good column for the New York Times, but this was a stupid polemic. Anyway, so I'll finish there, and I'm sorry I went on too long, and we can take some questions maybe.
Well, that was spectacular. I'm sure the audience is burning with questions right now. So.
I love that. That's just so fantastic. So I have a question. I think what I heard you say is that when you're comparing the resources and energy, which are subscalar, and then there's the information which is superscalar, right?
Superlinear.
Okay, so if you have a system that's got both of those in them, what I'm wondering is, does the information just suddenly take over, are cities essentially going to be just mostly information at some point?
Well, I can't answer that question, but I should have said the theory, what makes dealing with cities, and for that matter companies, much more difficult, interestingly, than biology, is that in this picture, in biology you can separate energy and the thermodynamics from the information, roughly. I missed your talk, which I'd love to have heard, on genomics. You can separate that from metabolism because the time scales generally are so different. Your metabolism is here today and so on, but I'm not, I may be evolving, but it's it's ridiculously slow, obviously. We are involved very, very so. So you can say the trouble in a city is that those two things, the time scales for those, come completely together. They overlap completely, so that a city in my own lifetime, socioeconomic systems have evolved fantastically. Think of all the extraordinary things, beginning with television onwards. Have come, and they have, revolutionized, maybe too strong a word, but they've had an enormous impact on our social life in terms of innovations. And so the theory has to integrate both of those. You can't treat them separately. And that makes it very difficult. But one of the things that does come out of that, so you have two kinds of networks. Okay, so let me back off a second. So there's a lot of work on network theory now. There's a huge amount. And the Senfe Institute was extremely important in developing that and so on. But that network theory is like those pictures I showed of social networks. It's somehow out there in cyberspace. You draw these pictures and you're just out there. But in real life, and in trying to get a theory of cities, each person is sitting on the ground somewhere, or on a street, or you have to put them somewhere. They can't just be a node on a piece of paper. So you have to do that. And it turns out, if you force that network to be anchored on a physical plane, which you call the city, which has its own network, then one of the things you learn from that is that the superlinear exponent, the 0.15 that you gain, that 15% added, should be exactly the same, in an idealized theory, the same as the 15% savings on infrastructure. So there's this intimate coupling between them. And I would say, now to your question, that in the present paradigm we have of cities, it's hard to see how that will change. The fact people still have to be, you have this image that you have a cell phone and you're sort of, you can talk to anyone, anywhere, and so on. But you and that person, I'm just repeating myself, have to be somewhere. And that is an enormous constraint. That physicality is an enormous constraint. So I think that remains. A related question is that, having said that, the fact that we can now communicate at an extraordinary rate between us over whatever distance we care to name, you might think would change all this. And in fact, when I first did all this, I thought, fantastic. We've stumbled across the way out of this, that all the assumptions that went into it and give rise to this fact that time is shrinking, this deflation of time. Time is getting shorter and shorter, things are getting faster and faster, so that we're going to have a heart attack trying to keep up with the treadmill, which I believe is what's happening. The way out of it is because somehow the invention of the internet and that kind of communication is somehow is going to avoid that, because you change also space. I've since changed my mind on that. I think actually, and by the way, I changed it because I read a great deal about the coming of the railroad and the coming of the telephone. And my strong impression, and I'm not an expert, is that they were easily, if not more so, revolutionary than the internet, amazingly. You know, I mean, you know, up until the railway, no one moved. I mean, in, you know, in zero approximation, very few people moved. Suddenly people could start, even ordinary people eventually could start moving. And the telephone was the first long-distance, true long-distance communication. We could talk across the transatlantic by before the end of the 19th century. And this had profound implications. And what did it do? All it did, in quotes all, was speed up life again. And that's what this is doing, I think. I think that the internet is simply driving us all nuts. And it's one of the few reasons I'm glad I'm 75 years old and won't be around very much longer, because I can't take it anymore. Oh, and that's the truth.
That was an amazing talk and a great, great extension to what you were doing before. I just want to raise two things that that may be behind also your tendency to say you want to be out of here.
Yeah, it's slightly tongue-in-cheek, obviously.
One is the rise of terrorism and the self-spontaneous evolving of cells, which I think, in my simplistic mind, is related to this network, great network that is established by the internet and communities that form on the internet without being physically next to each other. I wonder whether you have anything you'd like to say about that kind of a network, which could be seen as virtual cities in some ways.
Yes.
And secondly, I'll finish the 2 points. And
yes, sure.
If you look at the current election campaign in the US, there's a big thread of anger that's among the population that was, in some sense, undiscovered previously. And this could also be due to the media and the more selective kind of media that people look at and so on. So this also is a little bit of a virtual city kind of a situation. I'll be very curious to hear your thoughts about that.
Well, I can't, obviously, I don't have a definitive answer to either of those questions, but they are related. That was, that kind of thinking was why I thought there was going to be a change of some kind that was somehow outside of this. But in fact, you know, it's interesting to ask scientifically, is this election different than many elections in the past in terms of the actual dynamic, or is it that it's all got compressed into a few weeks instead of months? Because, you know, the thing about, I mean, people always were self-selecting. I mean, nothing to the extent they are now, I agree. People were also, you know, would respond to, you know, very extremists in various forms. So there's no sort of fundamental new dynamic that's going on, except that it's all happened so quickly. And the real problem is, I think, or one of the problems is that the collective dynamic, emergent dynamic, has changed time from being defined by the rotation of the Earth and the Earth going around the Sun. It's changed from that, and still exists, of course, from that to something that is driven by this positive feedback mechanisms that we've developed. But we haven't changed. This is still the same brain that it was 10,000, 50,000, 100,000 years ago, approximately. And, you know, making that adjustment is incredibly difficult. And my silly polemic a few minutes ago was a reaction to that, is that I'm, you know, especially at my age, I'm just finding it incredibly frustrating trying to adjust in real time to the phenomena that are going on around me. I left Sunday afternoon my house. I arrived here yesterday afternoon, 2 days in my life. I mean, they're not real 2 days, 15 hours different. I must be careful. The emails that piled up are so depressing in terms of number, you know, and demands. I mean, it's like, you know, what's the point? It's sort of like I feel deflated from coming here. And I thought, in fact, I thought when I saw that, I thought, why did I come? I should have stayed there. Life would have been easier. No, it's kind of, that's the kind of thing. It's silly. It's very silly and it's kind of puerile. But it's, that's what's changing. That this part has not been able to keep up in general. Well, I did delete quite a few this morning, but, so I don't know. No, these are just, you know, this is just speculation. Totally, I can't. I don't know. But I've sort of concluded, as I say, in my own head, that it just gets faster and faster, and the system collapses. You know, it's and the numbers, I think, bear it out. It's hard to see. We've had almost no intervention. The intervention has been minimal so far in dealing with it. You know, we're just beginning, it's just rising to consciousness a little bit. And one of the things that is interesting is this whole question of the pace of life, which sort of, I'd not thought about till I did this work, and it sort of popped out of the theory. I think, even though we all recognize it, has been given very little scientific study of itself. You know, I mean, the other thing that's happened, just to give you another example, is that in my, you know, growing up, this is almost a platitude. I grew up at a time when it was presumed I would get a job. My aspiration was to become a manager of Marks and Spencer's, believe it or not. And that I would have for life. You know, I'd end up in some, you know, maybe in, you know, in some bureaucracy of some kind. You know, that was my idea of success. But it was the idea that that would be it. It was that would be this continuous line. Well, you know, that's no longer the case. You know, our active lifespan is now much more than the, you know, natural 20 odd years or what it was, 25, 30, or whatever it was before, you know, 1850 or so. Now, you know, who believe it? That, you know, people of 80, 85 still very active, and they have 50 years or more, 60, 70 years of activity, and they have to change. So these are the things that are changing. It's time is changing. I don't think, I'm just rambling on. The answer is
yes. We have one question at the back. The lady. Yeah.
Thank you. I think this science of cities is a really important point to bring up, and particularly here in Singapore, yeah, where we have a really self-creating city that is a paradigm leader. And some also really interesting and important transitions and resistance to innovation that I think I'd like you to understand, because all cities are not the same, right? Even though they much of the infrastructure works in very similar ways, it's interesting to see how a city here with mega biodiversity is radically different in terms of, because of the environmental, very specific environmental conditions here, that gives it a really important role to play in creating a kind of mega infrastructure that can hack the Hadley cells of the climate destabilization and affect climate in the subtropical desert areas. But there's a kind of this idea of the city as an agent that has agency, and that if we can describe it, we can design it. And so this shift from centralized energy production, centralized waste production, to decentralized, you know, Malthus was wrong in a lot of ways, right? Because here we see that instead of having, you know, organisms boom and bust, we have, you know, a tree that grows 75 feet in 5 years, and we have increasing density in the natural ecosystems that really radically different from, cities in other contexts and therefore the environmental services that can be provided here, so air quality improvements. So this is an issue about Malthus's simple boom and bust and the designability of cities given their, if we really can say we can inform the design of cities with science, with evidence, can we shift a city like this towards distributed energy production and really environmental performance that actually improves and builds biodiversity and increases air quality as opposed to does less degradation, which is the current paradigm, right? Is that clear? That's a question about, I think.
Well, I'm not sure what the question is, but I'm happy to talk about it. So, and respond. First, I said, no, Malthus was wrong, I said. But Malthus was wrong because he didn't take into account innovation. But my point here is that even if you take into account innovation, the thing that you haven't taken into account is that you have to do it faster and faster, and you're not able to keep up. So if you believe this, we need another innovation, another paradigm shift, analogous to the power of the internet in the next 15 to 20 years. Okay, maybe it'll be. Maybe it'll be robotic cars. Who knows? That might be. Who the hell knows? But then, 15 years later, you've got to do another one. This is the problem. This is the issue. And we're just, it's conceivable, in my opinion, that had we been thinking about this at the time of it would have to be before, but even the time of the Club of Rome and Paul Ehrlich, had it been taken seriously, even though they were wrong, also, by the way, for exactly the same reason, but had we started 50, 75 years ago with some of these ideas, which I'm extremely supportive of, and I take your point, maybe we could have started thinking seriously about this and avoiding what looks like, a cliff edge. Looks like, my image is less a cliff edge than, this image of, you're on this treadmill that's just accelerating, which is hard enough, so you're running along hard enough. But then, every once in a while, you've got to jump to another one that's going even faster, and then you've got to jump to the next one. That's the issue. And, look, I wouldn't be here, all the things you said about Singapore, I wouldn't actually be here if I didn't know some of those things. Because one of the things that intrigues me about Singapore is that, two things intrigue me. One is, it's unique in the sense that it's a city-state of a kind that never ever existed, because it has no urban system associated with it, has no hinterland associated with it. So it's nothing like that has ever existed. The other thing about it is that it's been very open to doing all kinds of interesting urban innovations of various kinds. And it's been at the forefront of many things. One of the things I wanted to do, and I've never got anybody here to do it, is I think it should be one of the most interesting phenomena that has occurred, is of course the rise of a global urban system. So the question. So if you're in the United States and you're living in Los Angeles or Chicago, you're part of an urban system, and even if you stay parochially American-centric, you have, 365 metropolitan areas to compare yourself with and metrics and so on. Singapore has none. It has none because it doesn't have a hinterland. What it needs to do, because it has developed, is to look at the global urban system and see itself as part of New York and Rio and London and so forth. And I would love to see an analysis of that, but no one seems to be that interested. Is anyone interested, Peter? Here they are. Peter's here. Yeah.
Yes.
Singapore is a very, this is sort of a very interesting land of many things. And it's interesting. Of course, the other thing about Singapore is it has a different kind of democracy than many other countries. And that also plays, that's an important role. And in fact, one of the things that intrigues me about Singapore is that frankly, is that, you know, the system that the United States has is a system that was designed 200 years ago for, you know, 10 million people or whatever it was, which is in a small area. And now we've kept exactly the same system for 350 million people over an extended area, and maybe it doesn't make any sense. So looking at things like Singapore, which is this curious interface between something that's more top-down, but yet people have a role in it and so on, is a very interesting phenomenon. Not that, you know, I'm afraid I'm a born Democrat in the simplistic sense, but I do think it's really interesting to look at things like that and how that plays into some of the questions you bring up. Because the problem in the United States, among many European countries, is getting anything done. And so it's the political. So, you know, all this rubbish I've been talking about science of cities and understanding and so on, you know, unless the political system listens, bending at windmills? What's the phrase, the Quixote? Tilting at windmills, somewhat. So, and Singapore is effective to a large extent, I think, because you do have a system that allows for, you know, things to be carried out, and we don't. But we have other things.
Okay, can we have one last question from Mr. Peter Ho?
Geoffrey, I wanted to ask you kind of philosophical, but maybe it's also a dumb question. Is there a reset button? And the reason I ask this question is this. You know, we are all tilting at windmills, and a small country like Singapore with absolute physical limits is always having to confront issues of how big can we really grow, because we are limited by size.
Space.
In your presentation, I see the big challenge being the physical laws. You know, we're living in an accelerating universe, and at some point it must all collapse.
Yeah.
You talk about laws of entropy and all that. But the question is this. If you think of, you're a bit skeptical about the internet and all these revolutions brought about by computerization, IT. But in that, is there a possibility of some kind of reset, creating this kind of virtual city, virtual universe, which then resets everything, and a new kind of organization emerges, where instead of people having to run around all over the place, everything happens in place, and you already begin to see that. I was struck by a very interesting statistic. I've been very interested in 3D printing, and some studies of 3D printing says that if 3D manufacturing, additive manufacturing, really takes hold, then suddenly overnight, something like, I think it was a PW, Pricewaterhouse study, 57% of global container traffic will come to a halt because you don't need it anymore. Everything will be done at home.
Yeah.
So, you know, so we're just wondering whether things
I should have said, I mean, you've said it much better than I, actually. In drawing this scallop thing, each one of those should be thought of as a reset button. You start over again, effectively. You know, discover coal, zoom. Invent computers, zoom. Internet, zoom. So the question is that what kind of, you know, that is, it has been revolutionary. There's no question it was. I mean, that's another one of those things. But does it take us to a place? That's still the question. Does it take us to a place that is sustainable and doesn't demand yet another reset? This is the, you know, and we don't know that. We don't know that if any of this is to go by, you do have to have another reset in a quicker time. And, you know, in the end, for all the innovation, that you do have, and this is where you do get back to Malthus and to the Club of Rome, you do have resource restriction. I mean, we're going to run out at some stage of whatever. You know, and so there's either a faith statement that we can transition to solar energy, for example, to renewables. Because, as I said early on, just in a really big picture, the real problem is, in a certain sense, that we went from an open system, we forced ourselves to be in a closed system, you know, like those bacteria. And so if we could get back to an open system, then, you know, maybe this would still be sustainable. And, you know, we can find a way to reset in finite times and not have a heart attacks. So that's totally open to speculation as far as I'm concerned, but it needs serious study. And, we're just beginning to think about that. So this was more to, you know, it was in response to silent transformation, that these are the things that are actually silently happening to us. And it's a different take on the wake-up call. You know, we've got to take some of these things seriously. And the other part of it is a religious belief that if without science and without developing the basic science underlying it, I don't care how many studies are done by McKinsey and PwC and all the rest whom I do interact with and spend time with, it ain't going to work. So,
all right. Let's thank Professor Geoffrey West once again. And on behalf of Carolinas, I'd like to
thank you. Thank you very much. Yeah. Oh, that's very good. Thank you.